From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners from around the world, and thank you for tuning in to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I am your host, Dr. Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Anthony Charles, who is Professor of Surgery and Chief of Trauma and Acute Care Surgery at the University of Vermont. Dr. Charles is also an Associate Editor of JAMA, and he is author of a JAMA review on the topic of diverticulitis. Welcome, Dr. Charles, and thank you for joining us.
Oh, thank you very much for having me.
So I'd like to start off by having you tell us, what is diverticulitis?
Well, before we talk about diverticulitis, we have to really talk about what is a diverticular. And a diverticular is an outpouching of the submucosa, mucosa of a bowel wall that essentially bulges out the side. Diverticulitis is the inflammation of the diverticular.
And who is at risk for both diverticulosis and diverticulitis?
Certainly. So those who are at risk for diverticulosis are generally older adults, typically those over the age of 65. Those who have a family sibling who has had a history of diverticulosis or indeed diverticulitis. And those who are inherited connective tissue disorders, such as autosomal dominant polycystic kidneys, Marfan syndrome, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, typically have a higher prevalence of colonic diverticular.
Can you talk about the role of lifestyle or behavior with regard to diverticulosis? For example, what is current thinking about the role of diet in developing diverticula?
Certainly. So we are actually uncertain regarding the role of diets, or particularly sort of high fiber versus low fiber diet as regards the development of diverticular disease. Historical literature suggests that the Western diet predisposes one to diverticulosis. However, more recent studies that are colonoscopy-based have not shown any difference in the dietary habits between high-fiber and low-fiber diets and its association with the presence of diverticulosis.
Let's talk about how diverticulitis develops. Can you speak about the pathophysiology?
Certainly. So we have some hypotheses regarding how diverticulitis develops. So first of all, the diverticula is present with diverticulosis. And there's several hypotheses regarding how diverticulitis happens. First of all, we think that perhaps you have a micro perforation of the diverticuli with the associated inflammatory response. That's how a patient then typically presents with diverticulitis. Others think that there is an alteration in the gut microbiome that predisposes to pathogenic bacteria now causing inflammation of the diverticula. And that is a much more recent thinking. And lastly, the presence of bile and bile products, or so ursodeoxycholic acid, in lower than normal concentrations may predispose to diverticulitis.
What are the typical signs and symptoms of diverticulitis?
So first of all, diverticulitis is typically more common in the descending and sigmoid colon. The sigmoid colon is perhaps the area that predisposes the most to diverticular disease. The common symptoms of diverticulitis includes left lower quadrant pain, fever, and the patient will typically have a leukocytosis. People tend to think about sigmoid diverticulitis like a left-sided acute appendicitis, and typically present the same way. They may also have associated nausea and chills.
And if someone presents with those signs and symptoms and one is considering diverticulitis among the diagnoses, what diagnostic testing should be performed?
Certainly. The standard of care, or what I call the gold standard diagnostic test, is the contrast-enhanced CT scan of the abdomen and pelvis. And this typically will show you the presence of diverticulosis or indeed diverticulitis. You will see stranding and thickening of the bowel wall. You may indeed see pockets of air in the area of the diverticulitis, or you might indeed see a free air in the peritoneal cavity. And also, depending on whether or not it's a complicated or an uncomplicated diverticulitis, you may see evidence of a fistula, evidence of stricture, or indeed evidence of bowel obstruction.
So for somebody who has a history of diverticulitis, I presume they're at higher risk for developing it again in the future. And is it ever appropriate to treat empirically if somebody's presenting with symptoms of diverticulitis who has had it in the past?
So yes, it may be appropriate to treat the patients empirically if they've had a history of diverticulitis whereby they have had imaging study within the past 12 months. They do not have systemic symptoms of fever, chills. Their white blood cell count is so mildly elevated. And they are not elderly. They are not immunocompromised. They are not pregnant. It may be reasonable. However, if you're going to do that, then your follow-up for those patients, particularly if you're treating them as an outpatient, your follow-up should be short, should be within 3 to 4 days. They should be showing signs of improvements. Otherwise, you pretty much really need to have a diagnostic test to confirm.
Okay. And then what about someone who can't get a contrast enhanced CT scan? What would be alternative diagnostic tests you would recommend?
Certainly, more recently now, the use of ultrasound. It is possible to be able to diagnose diverticulitis using ultrasound. The greatest deficit to ultrasound, of course, is it is operator dependent. And you can also have the opportunity to use an MRI, if it's available, to diagnose diverticulitis.
Would those be better options than a CT scan without contrast?
You know, the CT scan is so ubiquitous, and people, both surgeons and radiologists, are very good at reading them, that a CT scan, even without contrast, even if you just have IV contrast and no PO contrast, you still should be able to make the diagnosis of acute diverticulitis.
Okay. Let's talk about treatment. First, is it ever appropriate to treat someone with diverticulitis without using antibiotics?
I think before I can answer that question, I think we have to sort of divide diverticulitis into uncomplicated diverticulitis and complicated diverticulitis. And so in uncomplicated diverticulitis, that is diverticulitis without the presence of pericolic abscess or localized abscess or free perforation or fistula formation, patients typically present with a left lower quadrant pain, fever, leukocytosis, and nothing else. They're usually able to tolerate an IV fluids. They don't have any systemic symptoms. Those patients can be managed without antibiotics. In fact, there have been randomized controlled trials that have compared antibiotic therapy with sort of conservative therapy, that is without use of antibiotics. And the outcome has been similar in terms of progression of disease or actually recovery. And so it is reasonable in patients that are young, healthy, preferably not even a compromise, that can be managed without antibiotics.
So can you just tell us a little more about your decision-making in those instances? For someone that's young and healthy, do you just not use antibiotics, or are there certain situations where you still use antibiotics in those cases?
So if someone is young and healthy and pregnant, I certainly would use antibiotics. Somebody who's got a history of recurrence diverticulitis, there's a higher chance that it's going to be more complicated. I certainly would use antibiotics. Anyone over the age of 85, regardless of disease, I certainly will use antibiotics in this scenario because a lot of the studies have excluded the subsets of patients. So those are the ones I would preferentially use antibiotics on. But if you had a sort of young, healthy, you know, even over the age of 65, localized disease, the clinical exam suggests that the pain is localized to the left lower quadrant. There's no evidence of sort of those systemic disease or generalized peritonitis. Certainly, we can treat without antibiotics. Otherwise, those patients will have antibiotics. Now, certainly, if a patient has peritonitis from a free perforation from a diverticulitis, then it's much more involved treatment. You need to get a surgical consult. They're going to be on antibiotics. They're going to be hospitalized. And they'll be looking at other surgical and non-surgical therapies.
I want to move on to discussing the selection of antibiotics. And as part of that, how do you decide whether to admit somebody for treatment?
Certainly. So first of all, if you have a patient that presents with signs and symptoms of diverticulitis and they can tolerate a diet or they don't have nausea or vomiting or anorexia, then I would manage them as an outpatient on oral antibiotics. And typically these patients can benefit from things like, you know, amoxicillin, clavulanate, or ciprofloxacin and metronidazole, or even cefalexin and metronidazole. Essentially, their symptoms are mild, they don't have systemic disease, they are still relatively mobile, they can tolerate PO intake. those patients I would treat with antibiotics as an outpatient. Now, for those by and large that have complicated disease that, or those that have uncomplicated disease that cannot tolerate our PO intake, I will then move towards IV antibiotics in those patients. And typical regimen include ceftriaxone plus bentonidazole, or even piperacillin tazobactam or meropenem in those patients.
In your review, you talk about complications of diverticulitis. I wonder if you could summarize the most common complications of diverticulitis and treatment for those.
Certainly. So the most feared and dreaded complication is really a sort of free perforation. So a patient has diverticulitis, it perforates, and then you have the free sort of egress of bowel contents that soils the entire peritoneal cavity. Those patients will typically present acutely. They may present in extremis. There's generalized guarding and peritonitis. They have leukocytosis. They're quite frankly septic. Those patients will be admitted to the hospital. They'll be volume resuscitated. They'll be placed on antibiotics. Their CT scan will have shown the disease process on the free air. And those patients will have a surgical consult instantly and most likely will be taken to the operating room to have an exploratory laparotomy, resection of the diseased bowel. And they may or may not end up having a colostomy or diverticulostomy. So that's one complication. And that's really the commonest complication. Other complications include things like just having a pericolic abscess or even an intra-abdominal abscess. And that is that you have a perforation, it's limited, it's walled off in the left lower quadrant, or even have a pelvic abscess. Those patients need to be managed with IV antibiotics. And in the presence of pus, if there's a collection of pus in the peritoneal cavity, the pus could be drained by vascular intervention or radiology, and the patient is on antibiotics. Other complications include things like colonic strictures, and these are typically in patients with recurrent diverticular disease that has resulted in stricturing of the colon. These patients will typically present with signs and symptoms of sort of change in bowel habits, sort of obstructive symptoms, thinning of the stool. And it's very difficult to differentiate stricture from diverticulitis from the stricture of colon cancer. And these patients ultimately will need a bowel resection. Well, colonoscopy first to biopsies and then certainly bowel resection. And lastly, other complications include fistula formation. And that is an abnormal connection between the diverticular colon and the bladder, a colovesical fistula, or a connection between the colon and the vagina, typically in patients that had a prior hysterectomy, a colovaginal fistula, or even a coloenteric fistula. And that can happen. Those patients will be managed with antibiotics, and ultimately surgical resection of the diseased colon will be curative.
And what about colonoscopy after diverticulitis? Well, first of all, is there any follow-up that's required with colonoscopy after diverticulitis? And if yes, what about the timing of that relative to the acute episode?
Certainly. So if a patient presents with acute diverticulitis, there is no role for colonoscopy in the acute phase of the illness. We typically will wait 6 to 8 weeks post the acute episode where things have cooled down to go ahead and do a colonoscopy. Now, in patients who are up to date with their screening colonoscopy, there's no urgency to do a colonoscopy, particularly if they've got uncomplicated diverticulitis. However, in patients with complicated diverticulitis, it is imperative that one performs a colonoscopy 6 to 8 weeks after the illness.
Is there anything else you'd like to add to our discussion?
Yeah, I think one of the greatest drivers of colon surgery now is acute diverticulitis. The prevalence of diverticulitis is increasing, particularly in those less than the age of 50. The disease is more aggressive. You have a high incidence of complicated disease. And we're seeing diverticular disease in younger and younger folks now.
Do we know why that is?
It is hard to tell. I wish I had the answer for you, but we don't know why that is. And that's why the issue of diet always comes into play.
I'm Mary McDermott, and I've been speaking today with Dr. Anthony Charles about his JAMA review on the topic of diverticulitis. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcast. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved. including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.